this is the PlayStation 3 version of the game. Do you know if there are any differences?
I'm told that the only difference is that it works on a PlayStation 3. The game itself was critically panned to the fullest extent, except from one magazine.
What magazine?
I think that was Play Magazine.
Fabulous.
The same one that gave Okami a 9 out of 10?
I don't know.
They gave it 9.5.
9.5, whatever.
But they gave this game a 9.5 out of 10 originally.
No.
Bumped it down when they heard the load times weren't fixed to an 8, I think. And then when the PS3 version came out, they gave it a 5 because, in fact, the PS3 version came out 2 months later and did not fix any of the load times or other graphics or controls flaws of the game.
Okay, Sonic the Hedgehog for the PlayStation 3 received a 43 average score on Metacritic.
Yeah.
Okay.
What's the average score on Metacritic?
I have no idea. They seem to be generally, I don't know, but it's in the red.
Well, because Metacritic is, well...
It aggregates a whole bunch of different things.
I don't think they actually do their own...
Exactly.
No, they don't.
But what's the average of the...
Oh, God, land!
So, Game Informer gave it a 68.
Out of
100.
Pretty
in
awful.
The end, Sonic Nuts will love it. Everyone else should stay away.
I am
Sonic
a Sonic
Nuts do not love this. I am a Sonic
Nut. I am a Sonic Nut, and I do not love this.
Peli in Finland says the 3D elements do not gel, and controlling Sonic feels awkward and hasty. Sudden deaths are far too common. Old school unplayability does not work this time.
Well, that sounds pretty accurate to what we've got so far.
This isn't old school unplayability.
This is just unplayability.
Now, here's something that's a bit off. The Games Master UK says lush graphics are marred by bad game design. But the
what
problem
is going on.
The problem I have with this that statement is that the graphics really aren't that good.
No, they're kind of like they're basically halfway in between a GameCube graphics and what a next gen game should look like.
A sort of uncanny valley.
There is an
not
uncanny valley.
Stupid valley is what this is.
Play UK said, a crushing disappointment for those who thought Sonic had finally found his feet in 3D.
Check the Xbox 360 version of that review, though.
Okay, why?
Because it got rated higher. I don't know whether it was Play UK or just Play US. But basically it was rated much higher on the 360 than it was on the PS3. Because the guy finally gave in to peer pressure.
Okay, for the Xbox... Play Magazine gave it an 85. You simply can't ask for more out of an action game. Mission accomplished. Sonic is born anew. The score was revised in the January issue due to long load times.
Only the long load times?
Because it was originally a 9.5.
Oh, okay.
Games Master UK, brilliant and fits
no,
and starts,
no.
But too
okay.
Mediocre.
Okay, so Mock Speed section.
Game Informer says, in the end, Sonic Nuts will love it. Everyone else should stay away. While it may please hardcore fans of the series with its addicting time-based action segments, Deco, I don't know what Deco is, but while it may please hardcore fans action segments, it will surely alienate everyone else thanks to its abundance of non-Sonic elements, RPG town wandering, additional less enjoyable characters, and a god-awful camera.
It's not the camera that's the problem, it's definitely the controls.
It is, in fact, both of these things.
Come on.
The camera is pretty terrible.
The camera is pretty bad.
Yeah.
But it's not number one.
It's not what is the game-breaking aspect of it.
It's definitely not a game maker, but...
OneUp Magazine says, if only the developers had focused on delivering a simple, fun experience, rather than trying to create something far beyond their reach. Game Daily nails it with atrocious camera angles lead to cheap deaths. The slippery controls make it difficult to get a handle on the characters.
Go back. Turn around. Go back.
The simple fact is that a dodgy camera, dubious controls, unspectacular visual.
Yeah! Yes! Amazing!
Get in there, you fucker!
Repeated falling to your death.
Okay.
Almost constant load.
Checkpoint reached.
Breaks.
Save game.
Have all but
no, you can't save in the middle
can't
of
save
stage.
During action stages.
Well, shit.
Gaming Age gave it a 0. Sega's decision to rush one of its most beloved franchises to the next-gen market has ended in a broken product that does not even deserve a rental. Well, that's definitely why we rented it.
Oh, come on.
Instead of bought it.
I think I'm going to start reading out more reviews of this game.
You should read, like, full reviews instead
Wait,
of...
Wait, we need to issue a new challenge.
Bottom lines. Like, we want full reviews instead of bottom
right.
lines.
Yeah, so I'm thinking, I'm going... let's read the IGN re- No, the let's read the IGN IGN review. So, the most common way to die in the ruined city of the future is undoubtedly... Undoubtedly death by lava.
What the fuck?!
Or to be more specific, its victims are typically bombarded by attacks from fire creatures, or accidentally fall into a pit of liquid hot magma. Try to imagine for a moment how unbelievably agonizing that kind of extermination would be. Though brief, the pain would be excruciating before your body went completely numb as your nerve endings melted away from the extreme heat. Seconds later, it's likely that your final dying thoughts would be those of terror, regret, and eventually nothing. In other words, it would be like playing Sonic the Hedgehog. Ugh! If you hadn't guessed it by now, the famous Blue Rodent's 15th anniversary didn't go over so well. In fact, the PS3 edition of Sonic the Hedgehog is one of the worst mishandlings of a big-name franchise in recent history. In truth, it's surprisingly difficult to know where to start with my list of complaints, since words like aggravating, sloppy, and boring don't even begin to describe what Sega has let loose here. I suppose the best place to start, though, would be with the most recurrent problem of the entire game, and that's with the camera and gameplay controls. To put it bluntly, both features stink. From open to close, the fully rotational camera is a disaster. It gets caught on buildings, trees, and other structures, and will frequently switch positions or angles for no reason at all. Start a conversation with one of the pointless NPCs, for example, and by the time the discussion is over, your viewpoint will have changed to a direction where you're not even traveling. This whole practice is disorienting and bothersome, and there's no reason for it. The camera issues also affect action stages. When playing as Sonic himself, the camera's angles change faster than a caffeinated schizophrenic, and when coupled with our hero's already speedy movement, leave unnecessary deaths as a byproduct. Things are also hurt by the fact that your characters can and will get caught on geometry at random intervals, so don't be surprised if you're suddenly stuck on a rock or permanently attached to a building because you brushed up against it. Of course, the final nail in the coffin is that the camera stick can't be customized and it's backwards by default. All told, these numerous troubles...
doesn't bother me at all.
Yeah, it doesn't bother me either.
Wait, what,
you know,
what are they...
Some people, like, really enjoy the normal camera.
I need, like, the flight camera.
Yeah, I need the backwards... I need backwards left and right. I need normal camera up and down. Well, maybe I don't. Depends.
How often do you adjust the camera while you're playing?
I only do it during... Sometimes.
Anyway, again, sloppy gaming is the best way to describe this monster. Though it's mainly a platformer, Sonic does borrow the hub world idea from Dreamcast's Sonic Adventure franchise and mixes it with ye olde run and jump, and it's one of its few commendable twists. The game offers a number of playable characters, and each have their own powers and uses, including high-speed stuff from Old Blue, telekinesis-driven object manipulation from Chrome, and complete vehicle destruction courtesy of Charcoal. But just like in other recent Sonic games, this newest foray doesn't mix styles very well. To start, the aforesaid hub world doesn't serve much of a purpose because it challenges you with needless mini-quests to unlock the next action level. They're tedious and slow, and the game would have moved at a much better pace without them. Controlling Shadow and Silver doesn't offer an entertaining reprieve either, because their stages run into just as many glitches or setbacks as Sonic's. The game just isn't fun to play no matter who you assume. Oh, and load times are awful too, often taking 15 to 20 seconds to access a 2 to 3 second cutscene before another 15 to 20 to go back to where you started. This happens constantly whenever your scenery changes are made, and what's even more infuriating is that these
no!
Story points aren't even pre-rendered. They're just alternate angles of the in-game engine they were using to begin with. Did I mention that most of these intermissions were forced to wait for are only 2 to 3 seconds?
Yes.
Alright, so that was page 1. What do you think so far?
I think he doesn't like it.
This review.
I think it's pretty accurate.
Yep.
Another of Sonic's problems comes from the visuals. To be fair,
the worst part is that we aren't even halfway through and we're already, like, down to the level of reading reviews.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know.
Oh my
God. Well, I mean, you know...
Another one of Sonic's problems comes from visuals. To be fair, the pre-rendered cutscenes do look great, and have some nice direction, but once the in-engine stuff kicks off, things start to roll downhill. Characters jitter for no reason.
We found that
we
one.
We found those. Shadows appear and disappear like crazy.
He
so
just did
Shadow.
That in that cutscene.
So does he.
And
an enormous amount of popping.
No, I'm definitely not supposed to be.
That's
what about
fine.
Popping?
Popping and locking?
We've had lots of popping.
Huh?
We've had lots of
Yeah, we've had lots of popping. Things just appear.
Yeah.
Pop in, okay.
It's the draw distance.
I thought you said popping.
Like, the draw distance applies where there's, like, there's multiple draw distances. Okay, these things get drawn when they're this far away.
I know what you're saying.
Yeah, okay. There's also a bunch of bizarre glitches that just scream rush job. Amazingly, there's a fair bit of slowdown and other frame rate hiccups when exploring Hubtown, too. Sometimes occurring even when there isn't a single character on the screen. To its credit, Sonic the Hedgehog does try to keep people interested with a number of features beyond the standard single-player game. A two-player tag and battle mode has been included, for instance, as well as multiple character episodes and some unlockable extras you can find along the way. The problem is that there's really no reason to play in it, any of it at length because of the poor camera, bad controls, and a convoluted multi-timeline plot that doesn't really go anywhere.
Nope, that was bad.
Closing comments. Sonic the Hedgehog is a mess. While there are a few glimmers of hope early on when players take control of Silver and his cool telekinesis, it's quickly realized that the game's design never really capitalizes on it. The remaining character situations, Shadow's vehicle segments, and Sonic's traditional platforming aren't anywhere near as interesting as Silver's, and the whole game has a forced and generic feel to it. Once you saute that winning formula with a rack of technical problems, you end up with one hell of a disappointing game.
Oh, classic siren noise.
Overall rating for this game, 4.2 out of 10.
Arbitrary number.
Arbitrary number. Gives this. What does X-Play give it?
Oh, that's a good question. Oh, The Onion did a review of this game.
Did you look for X-Play?
Huh?
Did you look for X-Play?
I did, but I hit The Onion first.
Okay.
That seems fair.
Some parts of the community believe that it's only a matter of time before programmers tame the complicated but immensely powerful PlayStation 3 and deliver some truly stunning experiences. But when a game like Sonic the Hedgehog stumbles into the next generation like a freshman accidentally walking into a string theory lecture, it becomes clear that some folks still need to brush up on their fundamentals. Sonic's 1991 debut on the Sega Genesis.
I do not like this part of the game!
Sonic's 1991 debut of the Sega Genesis worked.
Bitches!
Fuck yeah. Because it was a rush to run fast, collect rings, and ricochet through the scenery like a pinball, Sonic the Hedgehog does everything it can to distance players from these visceral pleasures. Your first task...
Motherfucking!
Oh, here we go. And even though the game is called Sonic the Hedgehog, two-thirds of play is spent steering Sonic clones Shadow and Silver. Only the most masochistic will ever get that far.
We're still at The Onion, right?
Yeah.
We gotta know.
Beyond the game, an overwrought Final Fantasy storyline complicates matters with tales of angry gods, time travel, and planetary destruction. Sonic even has a princess to save.
Adam
when human babe and anthropomorphic hedgehog bond prepare to be creeped out. Worth playing for. If gaming had its own Mystery Science Theater 3000,
I think
this game would be
its model. The CGI princess is definitely Uncanny Valley.
Sonic the Hedgehog gets 1 star out of 5.
I give this game a
1 out of 5.
That was all I actually wanted to do was set up that joke. Adam Sessler is a fantastic human being.
You don't necessarily know it was Sessler who did it.
I don't really care.
But I suspect that it was Sessler.
Someone once said you never get a second chance to make a first impression. However, Sega believes in second chances and more importantly that their target audience never played the original Sonic game. The blue fuzzball of Flash is back in Sonic the Hedgehog for the Xbox 360. A new hedgehog, larger environments, and named talent all add to the promise of new life for this dying franchise. Unfortunately, Sega is also a strong believer in breaking their promises and shipping out games before taking out all the bugs. The next generation of furries. It all began with a bang, fireworks to be precise, from the professional voice acting of the new slimmed-down model of Dr. Eggman.
Now?
The X-Play review.
They said a new generation of furries?
Yes.
Awesome.
You would think that Sega was really putting everything they had into this game, and then Sonic shows up. The barely 4 foot molded plastic model of a hedgehog never quite fits the elegantly designed cutscenes or anywhere else in the game. After the first of many loading screens appears, the attention to detail drops. Characters' flapping jaws often miss their dialogue if the programmers bothered to give them a mouth to begin with.
Princess Elise went to see Eggman by herself. Tell him, please help her.
Sadly, the cutscenes held together with a generous portion of loading screens may be the best part of this comedy of errors. The game quickly falls into the same pattern of trouncing around Soliana. Playing through four areas and then quickly shot out back to Soliana for another round of boredom. Traversing the Duplo-style houses is more tedious than challenging. People along the way will ask for your help or wave four polygons in a general direction that may or may not be your destination. Tasks from the 10 meandering townsfolk need cover attacking enemies, jumping through hoops, or running around the same dismal town. First, you need to accept the challenge, wait through a loading screen, listen to the person repeat the challenge, and wait through a second loading screen before taking on the task. Frequently, your task will take less time than the loading screens that took you there. There's no green hill zone here. Today's keyword is physics. From the typical ice stage to the typical lava stage.
You can grind.
Sonic displays a variety of box breaking, exploding, and at times bouncing around for no good reason. Our little Azure Froball hardly takes advantage of his newly acquired abilities. The game focuses on the powers of a certain gray-haired hero rather than his headliner. You better get used to the bland and often buggy areas of this little adventure. Sonic tends to send you back for seconds, often with a different character and few times.
So we're absolutely waiting for that. Oh, look at that tower just like fall down. Like everything else in the game sort of ponderously topples and crumbles. Like, this thing just goes wham, you're dead.
Which is part of the element of surprise.
Yeah, it's great.
And I think we had
Again.
Watching the video review of this game from X-Play.
Same exact thing.
Yeah, Adam Sandler is just like, by the way, thank you.
Adam Sandler?
I was waiting for him to get it himself. Adam Sessler, just like, out of the blue, he just talks about one of like the show-stopping bug, or bad gameplay decisions, and it is this tower. And then I watched that, and then I had a flashback.
Well, you watched that video on X-Play, and it's basically exactly what happened to us.
That's really the condensed
frame.
It's basically
frame to frame for what we did. And it's just amazing.
Game, I'm going to read a review by Games Radar. Game Daily, actually.
J to the U to the N to the K, this is junk.
Our score, bad.
Does it have multiple A's?
Sonic's days appear numbered as Sonic Team's ailing quality control issues continue to negatively impact its games. Last year, Sonic the Hedgehog for Xbox 360 joined previous failures, and this year's version for the PS3 follows in the game series' recent tradition and introduces a few of its own. Sonic battles the evil and Chaos Emerald-obsessed Dr. Eggman. This time, however, the lovely Princess Elise becomes embroiled in the plot. Eggman needs the princess's necklace to unleash the power of the emeralds.
Except none of that actually happens.
Necklace?
Yeah, I don't know about a necklace, but whatever. Sonic not only comes to her rescue and finds an emotional connection that makes him a love interest, two additional characters get thrown into the fold. The gun-toting Shadow and a new psychic-powered
Except
hedgehog.
Except he doesn't tote any guns in this game.
Yeah, whatever.
He only drives things that tote guns.
Hedgehog named Silver, who doesn't have the greatest of introductions. He fights Sonic in one of the game's most awkward boss battles. I wouldn't say that was the most awkward boss
battle. No, that was actually...
It was
tough,
it was
but
media.
It made sense
no, it
in
didn't.
Some ways.
It was cheap, but it was about media.
That's probably as
it
far
as
the person's
like
playing.
SA2 boss battle.
In addition, Tails, Knuckles, and other Sonic characters return. In between the action stages, Sonic visits the town of Soliana, where the princess lives before her capture. Here he talks with townsfolk and completes objectives. Unfortunately, these objectives have no tie-in with the story, and some of them don't make sense. For instance, one scenario requires Sonic to save a girl stuck on a rooftop before the townspeople clue him in on the princess's location. Furthermore, a shopkeeper possesses Sonic's light dash ability for no logical reason. Those
were
the two things I chose to nitpick.
I would not choose those two things.
That was
pretty surreal, though.
Okay.
I think it's, you know, he didn't play very far through the game, so he had to nitpick what he had seen so far.
Maybe. He hasn't seen half the shit, but anyway. Things get worse within the game's general action scenario. One stage requires Sonic to snowboard down a trouble-filled mountain. Sounds normal, as Sonic has snowboarded before in previous games. However, some irritating control problems arise. Steering Sonic left and right feels like a chore, and the game literally stops when the stage shifts into an Outrun the Giant Snowball scenario. Getting a grip on the controls takes 7 or 8 tries before figuring out how to survive the snowball's wrath or give up entirely. The running stages infuriate as well. Lacking any speed control, Sonic must avoid obstacles or hit ramps at just the right time, otherwise expect several instant deaths. You know what I just realized? Those speed stages are very reminiscent of the jet bike stages from the Mega Man X games.
No, they're very reminiscent of the fucking turbo tunnel from...
I thought you were going to say
Battletoads.
I was certain you were going to say Battletoads.
Also Battletoads, but I'm just saying because you couldn't see where you were going. Same thing with the turbo tunnel, actually.
It's Battletoads. We're just going to say Battletoads.
Yeah,
okay.
Turbo mother shit cunt waggling tunnel.
Because that links it with something that's more universally reviled.
Except that Battletoads had redeeming qualities.
No, so did Mega Man 8.
It had fucking awesome music.
Okay.
Yeah, Battletoads was fine. I have no problem with Battletoads.
Mega Man 8 was mostly good game.
Huh?
Mega Man 8 was mostly good.
What?
I thought Mega Man 8 was mostly good.
Oh, okay. Alright, so...
You know, I hated the jet bike. That's about all I hated about it.
In the X games, there were jet bike sections.
Oh.
And you would have, like, no warning as to, like, when you would have to jump in order to keep your bike. In addition to the usual hedgehog antics, Silver's psychic abilities allow him to move objects. However, his levels don't provide much of a challenge, except during some frustrating boss encounters. Not entirely
Which basically
fault,
means
though.
He never got past the first boss.
Not entirely
no,
fault,
I,
though.
That sounds like a
the
good
camera presents as much of a hassle as the boss character. Shadow's stages Mr. Mark 2, feeling like afterthoughts from his previous console release, which sucked. Tails, however, wins the award for worst controls in the entire fucking game. I added fucking. players maneuver Sonic's buddy through certain areas using the power of flight while providing him with ring bombs as his only offense. Unfortunately, instructing him to reach something as easy as a small ledge takes too many tries.
Instructing.
Several camera problems that plague the 360 version return to bother PS3.
Fast forward! Fast forward!
Fuck you.
Yeah, instructing.
That's what I was thinking of.
The loading time doesn't spare gamers from 15 to 20 second sessions between sequences, even for something as simple as a find the cop segment in the city. There's just no excuse for this. The PlayStation 3 version offers more hiccups in the visual department. Missing animation frames make the on-screen characters look unfinished. Slowdown constantly surfaces, forcing gamers to accept that the blast processing era appears over. The level design also seems to waver, with some levels where Sonic dashes across a chasm on a windstream looks spectacular, and others where running around an all-white snow maze turn up lackluster.
Time to mention all!
The soundtrack offers some decent musical fare, including an acoustic redux on an old Sonic theme, but most of the songs get drowned out by the annoying voice work. Sonic and company treat this like a serious affair, but possess cheesy dialogue. Even Lacey Chabert, Party of Five Mean Girls, fails to give life as the voice of Princess Elise. Sonic the Hedgehog for PS3 most notably suffers from lack of momentum. If Sonic can't run at full speed like he's meant to, he ceases to be important.
Yeah, but... Oh!
Oh. And suck me in too much, and that's that. Let's let Illuminati Vespucci give it a try.
Oh dear.
This is really hard, but it's at the same time not fun at all. It is frustrating when the things that are causing you to die are sort of tricky to describe. I mean, the purple things suck you in. Okay, you know. How hard do they suck you in? How close do you have to be for them to suck you in? It's... All you know is to, you know, stay away from them, if at all possible, which is pretty much never. You can't stay away from them because they're everywhere and they're specifically put in your path.
My problem with this section is that there are instant death pits that are sucking, but that's not the worst part. There are two things that are worse than that. One is... One is that they're close together. Another is that they are often while you're trying to fly or hover or something or jump.
Yeah.
And third is there's another type that spews boxes at you while you're trying to
the orange ones.
While you're trying to hover yeah. away
the
from
out.
It. Yeah. Don't know why they decided to include those.
They seem largely unnecessary.
And they don't really make sense considering what the distortions are
yeah.
supposed to be.
Well, and what you, no, I think really what the root of it is that we are dealing with an obstacle that alters your controls in a game where the controls are already inadequate. If the controls were tight, and this was really the first thing in the game that says, ha ha, now I am messing with your controls, they'd be
oh.
perhaps frustrating,
oh,
but maybe bearable. You know, but the fact that we, for the whole game, it has been an uphill battle against the extremely, I don't know, would you call them floaty, or loose, or just wacky, or just maybe bad?
I call
them
bad.
Just flat out?
I call them just flat out bad.
I mean, it's that you do not feel that in this game you are in complete control of your character at any time.
I ran out of energy so quickly that
yep.
time.
Because even if you're not ascending, you run out of fly energy.
But I ran out of energy slower last
oh.
time.
Who knows?
When I was
I can't
not
explain
in
it.
The correct place.
There you go. So basically, it is presenting to you a challenge that you do not really have the tools to defeat. To defeat a control-based challenge, you must have controls. And you don't. So I say, no contest. This, I'm not saying it is impossible. It is certainly possible. What I am saying is that from a from a adversarial, you know, game designer v game player scenario, this is
like,
the case at
Sonic
which
King
the game player
it.
Says, this is bullshit, this is unfair, I am taking my ball and going home. You know,
I think
do your best,
better
but
at the hedgehog
realistically
ones.
With one life.
There was a thing just floating in midair, I'd like to point that out. There was a box, simply, or not a box, but a part of the box, simply floating in midair. Very
oh, that's reasonable. No, it really isn't.
Yeah,
lots of really unreasonable things have been going on in this game. In so many other games, I can just sort of suspend my disbelief and be like, okay, something wacky is happening. Well, okay, that's fine. I'm playing a video game. This isn't real life. But what do you say to a game that breaks the rules of video games? You know,
you call the police.
Do we call the police and tell them that Sonic 2006 is illegal and Sonic Team is going to jail? I mean, like, control-based goofiness works in a game such as Mario Galaxy, because the controls in it were much more manageable.
Well, that's not just the only thing. The other thing is the camera was also manageable, and as we just saw, the camera enjoys fucking with you in this game, so...
Mario Galaxy did not have a perfect camera, but it had a pretty good camera, and it, you know, maybe didn't have perfect controls, but it had pretty good controls, so when the game says to me, alright, here is a clever challenge involving things that may temporarily alter the way you control your characters, I say, okay, that's fair. I'll give it a shot. And I might not get it my first try, I might not get it my 10th try, but at no point do I feel like I have been asked to do something that is simply unreasonable. This game is unreasonable. You try to reason it. You can't.
Don't look towards Eggman's insidious devices to hand you your toe tag. It's the falling tower hidden by the camera that kills you in the end.